On July the 30th, 1998, outside the Royal Courts of Justice, there was a media frenzy. Maria Bentley Dingwall faced the press to announce the end of the longest fight for justice in British legal history. In 1953, her uncle, Derek Bentley, a 19-year-old with a mental age of 11, was sent to the gallows for a crime he didn't commit. His conviction had finally been quashed at a court of appeal. His family's 45-year battle for the truth was now over. But there was clearly somebody missing. Maria's mother and Derek's devoted sister, Iris, who spent her life fighting for justice and campaigning to clear Derek and the Bentley family name. Iris had lost her own battle for life in January 1997.
And I think it's not merely the strength of the campaign that Iris Bentley and others have waged that is important. It is also the fact that this case has come to symbolise the problems with the whole system of investigating miscarriages of justice.
She just was a Sherman tank. She just went on and went on and went on.
I want his name cleared of murder. He didn't murder anybody. He was on the rooftop, yes, he was breaking the law, but he didn't murder or hurt any police officer.
She's one of those wonderful English working class ladies who had a very hard life. But through that, there's an incredible sense of humour and life.
She was brave, she was smart, you know, politic, very warm and generous to me.
I expected to find a much tougher person. She was very vulnerable, much more vulnerable than I thought. I thought she'd be quite brash. I thought she would be quite arrogant, really.
Those images of Iris every year trooping up to the prison and laying those flowers, I mean, and watching her grow older in front of your eyes each year, doggedly marking that occasion was something that was deeply affecting because it was done with such dignity.
I admired what she did and kept doing all through her life in order to clear her brother's name.
What happened on that Croydon warehouse rooftop in 1952 has become a British legend and the subject of books, documentaries, plays, songs, and even a feature film.
The police had arrived, and when they saw them, you can bet.
What hasn't been told is what drove Iris and her family to fight for that justice and of those who helped them on this sometimes impossible journey.
I look back upon it as one of the two or three films of my last 15 years of my career, which made it worthwhile.
Action!
Don't be so bloody stupid.
This place is surrounded, you hear me?
Don't try anything, all right?
He's got a gun.
Come on, son, game's up.
Get back, cover!
Give that thing to me.
These words that were never actually said, and the gunshot...
Let him have it, Chris!
...were to reverberate through the halls of British power and justice for the next 45 years. The Bentleys came from South London. They were just normal working class folk. William and Lillian wanted a big family, but luck didn't smile on them. Three children died at birth, another just after his first birthday. Their home was destroyed in the Blitz.
Derek.
It's all right.
Don't worry, son.
It'll be all right.
We'll get you out.
Can you hear me?
Daughter Joan was killed, and Iris and Derek narrowly escaped two bombings. Almost being killed together and losing their sister was to create a bond between Iris and her brother that would never be broken.
For the first few years of his life, according to his father's book, he wasn't retarded, he was very bright. But he was injured in the Blitz and then he fell off a wall later, and at various stages things happened to him and his brain seemed to become affected.
It was Iris's job very much to look after her baby brother. And if this meant not going to school or sitting in his class rather than hers, that's what she did.
We used to go in for our mark, and then the master used to come to my class and say, he's gone home. There used to be a hole in the wall, because we only lived next door to the school. And he used to go home to my mum and say, I've had enough now, I've come home to you. And I used to have to go and get him and then go back and then sit in the classroom with him.
Derek was only 18 months younger than her, and he was mentally subnormal, and somebody had to look after him.
All her life, Iris carried this crumpled picture of Derek in her purse. This is how she always saw her little brother.
I mean, I'm not trying to paint him white or anything like that, but he was, how can I say, so gentle. I don't think I've ever met such a gentle person like him since.
Norbury today looks much the same as it did after the war when the Bentley family moved to Fairview Road to rebuild their life. But times were tough and normal everyday things were hard to come by. The black market and petty crime were booming. Even Derek got his fingers burnt and he was sent away to an approved school. When he came back, for a year he wouldn't leave the house. It was only Iris who could get him out.
Hello, Iris.
Stella. This is my brother Derek. What was it you wanted, Derek?
Have you got Wheel of Fortune?
K-Star. Fancy her, do you, Derek?
Yeah.
Life at the Bentleys got back to normal. Derek got himself a job, although he continued to suffer from epileptic fits. Iris had a twinkle in her eye and loved to go dancing. In the summer of 1952, her 21st birthday party lasted for 3 days. She was now an usherette of the Streatham Astoria and was engaged. Then Derek started hanging out with Christopher Craig, the 15-year-old brother of a local villain. On the night of November 2nd, 1952, Derek went out to meet Craig. He never came back.
Come on, Chris, let's blow.
Look, Del, are we going to do this or what?
The night the police came to our house and took my father into the lounge and pushed me out and said, your son has shot a policeman.
The Bentleys knew PC Miles, the murdered policeman. William used to mend his radio.
And my dad said, never, he wouldn't kill a fly.
Dennis Bentley, Iris and Derek's younger brother, was just 9. For the first time, he has spoken about the night Derek was arrested.
And you can imagine they were screaming and crying and the voices raised. And they were in my brother's room and searching it, presumably. And after that, our lives were tipped upside down.
Derek's trial only lasted 3 days. Iris, her mother and father and Dennis waited outside the courtroom. William was sure he'd be called as a witness. He was never called.
They were simple working class people who, of course, were very poorly equipped to take on the might and majesty of the judicial system in this country, let alone the body politic. Very, very bright, talented people have faltered at trying to do that.
My wife and I were so distressed that we sent a telegram to the Home Secretary, who was David Maxwell Fife, asking him to reconsider. And then afterwards, we found that lots of other people had done the same thing.
Evening News reporter Ken Allen was at the Bentley home for 2 weeks leading up to Derek's execution.
I was there on the day when the news came, but it wasn't the news that everyone expected. The mail was coming in vast quantities, large. It was petitions that people were getting up all over the country and sending in. And the postman used to bring all this mail in sackfuls, and Bill Bentley would empty the sackfuls in the bath.
The way the Bentley family were told that there was to be no reprieve for Derek was devastating. They were expecting a Home Office messenger with the decision, but instead were told by a newspaper reporter. William found this letter buried amongst hundreds in the bath. A pattern was set that day for the Home Office treatment of the Bentleys for the next 45 years.
When I heard that Bentley was not going to be reprieved, which was only 2 days before he was due to be hanged, I was terribly shocked. It seemed to me all totally against natural justice that the man who had fired the shot, which killed the policeman, should be detained for whatever it was, 10 years, and the man who hadn't, who was his accomplice, should pay the full penalty.
Well, I'm a Croydon boy, actually. I grew up in Croydon, and in 1952 I would have been about 7 or 8. And I couldn't, my young mind couldn't get it on board. First of all, you know, everyone was talking about it. I began to see this whole thing in the end as a bit of a class thing, I've got to be honest. It was the judges and the people at the time in power were very much from the public school situation. They had very little understanding of the working class. There'd been a war. Somebody had to be banged up for this.
This was the early 50s. Times were, you know, delinquents, cosh boys, spivs. And Derek Bentley was bracketed very much with those kind of people. And this was the excuse made when they say, well, you know, he wasn't any good anyway. So what's, you know, what's the loss of one like that? That was very much the attitude. And I think it genuinely was the attitude. And Iris and her family felt that very, very deeply, that somehow they were tarnished with this brush, but also they were also responsible for Derek's death, because had the family been a better kind of family, then Derek wouldn't have been allowed to go down this path and it would never have happened.
Overnight, they just turned to old people. I mean, they were very young. We was always a happy family, you know, a very young family.
On the day of Derek's hanging, there were riots outside Wandsworth Prison, and Iris handed back her engagement ring.
I gave them the ring back on the morning they killed Derek. I didn't feel that I could leave my mum and dad.
After Derek's death, the family asked for the return of his belongings.
They had been burned.
Twice a year, Iris and her parents would take flowers to the prison on Derek's birthday and on the anniversary of his hanging. William Bentley wrote time and time again, begging for permission for his wife to visit and mourn at Derek's grave. Each request was denied. Public records are normally made available after 25 years. In Derek's case, the Home Office changed that ruling to 75 years. It wasn't until 1992, after Iris winning a fight to bring their disclosure forward, that she discovered the horrific contents of the prison and Home Office letters. All the flowers they had taken were never put on Derek's grave, but were always destroyed.
Inhumanity shown by the Home Office here, year after year, in the way they handled relations with the family, was appalling. Secondly, openness in government is disclosed by this. There was no reason why these letters should not have been made public, put into the public domain many years earlier.
Any police officer that went past would stop me and ask me what I was doing. If I was in a police car, they'd ask me to get in the police car, and I was always referred to as Young Bentley, always Young Bentley. And later on, I did actually have a police officer say to me that we hung your brother, we'll hang you one day.
Iris and her family were evicted from One Fairview Road, a house full of memories of Derek. Seeing her mum and dad so distressed and humiliated would in later years make her even more determined to fight on.
They loved that house. And then when they said, you know, they had to go because we brought bad publicity to Norbury.
In 1961, she married Stuart Dingwall, but Derek was always there.
Which now was a failure, because he kept throwing it up in my face, you know, if he had an argument.
They had a daughter, Maria, who she doted on. After 15 years of writing to the Home Office, permission was given for Derek's body to be reburied in a Croydon cemetery. 5-year-old Maria was there that day.
Mum explained the story. She said, well, do you remember me telling you that Derek was killed, and well, we've just got his body, and they're going to say goodbye to him today. So that's how Mum explained it to me. It was very simple.
William Bentley's letter-writing campaign was going nowhere, but in 1969, author David Yallop began his own investigation. His book and TV play were to reignite the case.
They didn't know where to go. They didn't know what to do. I did. I lobbied MPs. I realised that this was where it had to happen. And with Bob Parry, for example, managed to get an early day motion, which was signed by nearly 300 MPs, which is nearly half the House, cross-party. And that sends a very important signal to government.
At this office in Southwark, William Bentley was to find a remarkable lawyer who would fight with them for justice for 30 years.
I silently pledged to the old man, to old William Bentley, when he came in on the week he died, that I would continue the fight, and having done that, I felt I had that obligation to continue the fight. And this has straddled the whole of my career, my professional career, really, from just about 2 years after I started my practice right up to now. I really was determined, ultimately, not to retire before I'd done my part in trying to rectify this appalling injustice.
In the 70s, both Iris's parents died. Now it was down to her.
She started this indomitable campaign, and from, I think, about the early 70s, it was the only thing she did in life, effectively. She was campaigning wholeheartedly to rectify the wrong.
He's got to have that name cleared, killer of a policeman or murder. I mean, when I got married, it said killer's sister gets married. My daughter was up for election a few years ago, and it said killer's niece up for election.
Every year, as a sign of respect for Derek and her parents, Iris continued to take flowers to Wandsworth Prison. For her, this was a moral injustice, not just a legal one. But each year, as the case dragged on, with it came more and more boggling legal documents.
Certainly when she started off, you know, not every member of the family, you know, we didn't have that early knowledge base of basic law, and we didn't need to. But it's something that Mum acquired over the years.
That does not mean to say that she wasn't intelligent. She was. She was very bright. And, for example, she picked up words, that new words that I would teach her or use in conversation, and she'd say, what does that mean? And I'd explain. And she would never make a mistake about how she used that word afterwards.
Iris had been diagnosed in 1974 with cancer and had major surgery, but she told her doctor that she was far too busy to die. In 1990, she became very close with the cast and crew of the feature film.
Iris felt it compromised on a certain points, like the inclusion of the line, let him have it. And I agree with that. I agreed with that at the time. I thought it was a cop-out. But it raised public awareness. She'd become, to a certain extent, a political animal. She knew it was useful. It put it in the public arena again.
She went to the States with the film, Let Him Have It. She gave me an awful lot of time. She talked to journalists locally, nationally, internationally. I think she was just one hell of a fighter. I've never known anybody with that sense of resilience.
I kept in touch with her, and I used to call her up sometimes at 5 a.m. when I wake up in LA and just have a long chat with her about everything. She was always talking about her disappointment.
Documentaries by Roger Cork and Carol Peters had discovered vital new evidence about the safety of Derek's conviction. At last, there was hope. In 1992, Home Secretary Kenneth Clark held a press conference.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I've completed my review of Derek Bentley's case. I have come to the conclusion that there are no grounds for a royal pardon.
Iris was patiently waiting at the Bernberg office for news.
She wasn't at the press conference. The press conference was given to journalists, and she had been informed that she would be the first to know. This was the great line, "I can't tell you anything," said Kenneth Clark on the Today programme. "I've told Iris Bentley she will be the first to know." She wasn't the first to know.
Mum was angry. She said, just the way they treated us back in 1952, they didn't have the decency to wait to let us hear before they tell everybody else.
She was in tears and very low, at a very low ebb, very depressed by it all. And at times like that, had the feeling that enough was enough, she couldn't take it anymore.
But I'm not going to give up. No way. He was innocent, and I'm going to fight and fight.
And fight she did. Within a year, she had challenged Kenneth Clark's decision at the High Court.
I'm just hoping I'll come out at the end, you know, with Derek's name cleared. That's all I've been fighting for, and for British justice.
After Iris challenged Kenneth Clark's decision, the Queen, on the advice of the new Home Secretary, Michael Howard, granted Derek a posthumous pardon, but for Iris, it wasn't enough.
No, there's still a bit to go. I want his name cleared of murder. He didn't murder anybody.
The way they treated Iris and knowing that she was ill was utterly, utterly appalling and cynical, because this could have been speeded up and that poor woman might have had the satisfaction of knowing that she had achieved what she set out to do. And the fact that she was denied that, I think, is outrageous.
My mind's OK. It's just my body, you know, has been giving out with the cancer. This is my fourth tumour I'm fighting.
This one, unfortunately, can't be cured. It's only just being held back. But I'm hoping it's held back long enough, you know, to get my brother's pardon. Then I don't mind going to meet Derek and say that I did it before I got up here. But that, you know, fighting cancer is very hard. But I've put that to one side because I want to clear Derek's name.
Even when Iris was dying, we went to the Home Office, pleaded with them to consider the dossier we prepared for a reopening of the case and of the conviction, to give Iris the opportunity of seeing this done while she was still alive. And again, that fell on deaf ears. Nothing was done.
Iris died in January 1997, and she left her small home in Colliers Wood to be buried with her brother Derek, her father and her mother. Eighteen months later, Iris's lifelong dream came true. Derek's case was quashed.
It could be somebody else's brother, somebody else's son, that's wrongfully convicted. So that's why I must continue for everybody.
If it wasn't for her, it probably wouldn't have got to this point. But I'm sure she's totally content now that her brother's name was cleared.
Unbelievable, really. Unbelievable that she didn't see it. In a funny way, makes sense, considering the anguish she went through. But that's life, really, isn't it? It's not a fairy tale.
She would never have said, yes, I've won, but I think she, like us, had a pretty good idea that with the new body that had been set up that was independent of the Home Office, that they wouldn't go down the same route.
Sadly, Derek Bentley's case has revealed a lot about the Home Office and their treatment of individuals.
It's this cult of secrecy that I think is one of the worst aspects of government, and particularly of the Home Office. We need to see much more open government.
I was, of course, absolutely delighted that I and many other people had been vindicated. We were right and those bastards were wrong, particularly those Home Office bastards were wrong.
They had everything there that they could have proved that the whole case was unsafe and that my brother should have still been alive today.
On November 10th, 1998, Maria Bentley Dingwall and Dennis Bentley were invited to a private meeting with Home Secretary Jack Straw to discuss compensation. Overnight, the Home Office issued a press release. They now await the outcome.
Let me inside you, into your room. I've heard it's lined with the things you don't show. Lay me beside you, down on the floor. I've been your lover from the womb to the tomb. I dress as your daughter when the moon becomes round. You be my mother when everything's gone. She will always carry on something.